Understanding more about the sector that touches every part of our lives. Coming up on the programme, we'll take a look at innovations within the oil and gas industry and the challenges and opportunities on the road ahead. From exporting oil to exporting knowledge, the changing role of research and development. Collaborating with renewables and hydrocarbons, what role will they play in the energy mix of the future?
And coming up, I'm in Oman at what will be one of the world's largest solar energy plants, and it's on an oil field.
Hello and welcome to Journey of the Drop, a programme by the World Petroleum Council and ITN Productions. I'm Natasha Kaplinsky. Now, over the next hour or so, we'll take a look at what's happening within the oil and gas industry today, as well as the innovative solutions that will create a bright future for operations and their stakeholders tomorrow. The journey of the drop is a long one and one that won't be rushed. It takes millions of years to create the fuel that many of us take for granted in our daily lives. As Willem Marx explains, by the time the drop has reached the barrel, it's come a long way.
Billions of years ago, the Earth's oceans teemed with marine life. When these small organisms sank to the sea floor, the lack of oxygen transformed them into an organic compound called kerogen. Time, pressure, and extreme temperatures then reform this collection of carbon and hydrogen atoms into a drop of oil. As we follow that drop on its journey, it joins trillions of others, forming vast reservoirs beneath the Earth's surface, encased by rock and awaiting discovery. Mankind began seeking out that drop more than a century ago. And today, some of the planet's brightest minds and most advanced technologies are searching for that drop, scanning oceans, deserts, and everywhere in between. Whether the drop exists in a conventional or non-conventional deposit, increasingly efficient extraction techniques are employed to bring it to the surface. There, the drop is refined into petroleum products. They allow that drop to power our factories, build our streets, fashion our clothes, develop our fertilizers, our medicines, our electronics, and all of our plastic goods. It fuels the cars we drive, the trains we take, the ships we use, the planes we fly. The drop heats our water, it cooks our meals, it lights our homes. And so a drop that's derived from ancient life plays an integral part in our modern lives.
Now, one of the key challenges facing the oil and gas industry is calculating which fuels will be important in the future energy mix, as well as the many challenges and opportunities these energy sources will create. Willem Marx went to a WPC workshop in Belgrade to get some perspectives from the petroleum industry.
We're in the Serbian capital of Belgrade for a workshop meeting of the World Petroleum Council.
Experts here will be focusing their discussions on the future role of petroleum in the world's energy mix.
WPC members include public and private companies, as well as governments. But all of them recognise the multiple challenges that must be met to build a sustainable future by focusing on issues including population, price, supply and demand.
What we see over the past couple of years, the name of the game is speed, speed of the changes, happening in 3 months, 3 years, not beyond that.
Energy needs and use in different regions will transform as the world's population grows, especially in countries like China and India.
I expect that there will be big changes, huge changes, but there is one criteria which remains, I think, stable, that the world will be supplied by energy on the basis of an energy mix.
Over the next century, energy poverty will end for 2 billion people in the developing world. China and India have burned a lot of coal in recent years, but oil and gas could potentially offer cleaner and more sustainable solutions to meet rising demand there.
Of course, there will be new energy sources helping out filling that gap. That includes solar, wind, nuclear as well, and hydro, but oil and gas are there too, also for the long term.
There's no doubt that energy supply sources are shifting.
The expectation is that the share for renewables besides nuclear will be increased a little bit, but still the fossil fuels will keep its big portion in the next few decades to come.
But the correlations between world events and energy prices are also shrinking. In the past half century, the oil shock, Gulf War, and 9/11 all prompted oil prices to spike. But in recent years, global developments like ongoing violence in the Middle East have not caused the various price fluctuations.
It's not happening now. Look at the conflicts and crises we are going through. And the oil prices are largely unaffected. Why? Because we are in a new era in which resource abundance is the name of the game again. There is no resource scarcity.
That's because in the past 5 years, with the impact of shale gas developments, countries like the US have stopped importing so much oil and in some cases are now net energy exporters.
Most of the growth in the global oil consumption will come from Asian countries and the Middle East. And on the contrary, in the West, in Europe and US, we will see a decline in the oil use.
Still to come on the journey of the drop. Combating the consequences of carbon. How to reduce emissions in big cities. And to discuss this and much more, I'll be joined by the Director General of the WPC, Dr. Piers Reamer. Hello again and welcome back to Journey of the Drop. To discuss the challenges and the opportunities within the industry, I'm pleased to say we're joined now by Dr. Piers Reamer, Director General of the World Petroleum Council. Hello, lovely to see you again. Thank you very much for coming in to talk to me. We're talking about the journey of the drop. It's come an awfully long way, hasn't it? And the 21st century brings new and exciting challenges.
It does. And from the start of the industry, we've had many challenges. We've been responsible for economic growth, for social enhancement, and for all the things around us today. And that continues into the future. Nothing ever stops still in this industry, and we're continually looking at new science and technology and innovations for the future, and a way to provide the growing world population with a clean, sustainable source of energy for the future.
And looking to the future, you do have to future-proof the industry, don't you? And how on earth do you do that when there's such a big demand?
We do. We know what we have to produce. We know that today we might be producing just over 90 million barrels of oil a day. And in the future, we're going to have to produce over 120 million barrels a day. So we know there has to be significant investment in the industry for the future. We also know, after the climate change talks in Paris, that we have to do a lot more to produce a more sustainable fuel. We have to produce less greenhouse gas emissions. We need to do things more efficiently. We need to move into refineries of the future, produce biofuels, and get involved with more renewables.
Well, let's talk a bit more about renewables then, because it's important, isn't it, as an industry to embrace them rather than to see them as a big challenge and just competition.
They're not really competition, because when you look at all the studies, all the activities going on to 2050, we're going to need everything. We have a growing population, we have, well, over a billion people to bring out of energy poverty. And so we will be in a position where we will need all the energy we can get.
Okay, let's look ahead then to the 2017 Congress in Istanbul. What would you see then as your key focus points there?
Our topic is bridges to an energy future. We have the bridges in Turkey. Turkey is an energy hub, and so much of Europe's oil and gas flows through Turkey at the moment. But at the Congress, we concentrate on everything associated with the oil and gas industry. So we'll be looking at all the predictions for the future, where the industry is going. We'll be looking at the latest advances in science and technology. We'll be looking at what the industry is doing on climate change. We're also embarking on a major program with the OPEC Fund for International Development, where we're looking at energy poverty issues. We're working with the World Bank on reduction of gas flaring, again in Africa, which can help positively contribute to the reduction of energy poverty. We're looking at young people, all the new people coming into the industry. We're looking at gender imbalances, and we're doing a big study on gender equality and women in the industry. So we're covering every aspect of the oil and gas industry in Turkey next year.
Certainly looks to be a very busy time. Dr. Pierce Riemer, thank you very much indeed for coming in today to tell me a little more.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Governments are making meaningful environmental commitments. Society wants a low carbon economy, and green technologies can make it happen, but only with the support of large-scale financing from the private sector. Bank of America Merrill Lynch, who kick-started the rapid global growth of green bonds, knows that innovation and expertise are also necessary to help clients successfully diversify their energy mix and continue moving green technologies into the mainstream.
The flowers are blooming in the mild autumn air, but the effects of global warming aren't so benign everywhere. The race is on to limit the rise in the Earth's temperature to 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels. And since the UN Climate Change Conference, known as COP21, in Paris in 2015, this commitment is binding on the 195 countries that signed. It's led to a surge in green projects, which all need financing.
If you put your climate bifocals on, you get a sense that the long-term direction of travel is now set in stone. There is a cap on emissions. The Paris Agreement has a ratchet, which will likely tighten over time. So companies are tuning in to that reality that there's a need to recalibrate some business models.
Bank of America Merrill Lynch has carved out a niche in green finance as part of its vision to back sustainable growth globally. It's particularly active in green bonds, where investors lend money to issuers for a fixed period in return for interest. But are they a good investment?
The beauty of the green bonds that we're working on, which are what we call use of proceeds green bonds, is that they are identical from a credit and a yield standpoint to the investor. So that means all of the regular investors that would normally buy a regular bond from that issuer can buy the green bond, and they do buy the green bond. But we also have this growing groundswell of green investors that specifically want to buy the bond because the proceeds are going to green projects.
In the energy sector, the bank is starting to see all stakeholders, regulators, consumers, corporations, and politicians wanting to move towards green energy. It's predicted $70 trillion are needed to finance clean technologies by 2040 to meet global climate change commitments. Oil and gas companies are shifting their business models, but they need to do more.
If you look at what all the oil companies are doing, they're putting some of their best people, setting up divisions to start to work that. It's probably on a 10-year view from now. I just think the critical thing is for that to come forward, because otherwise I think with technologies keep accelerating the time at which that crossover happens, you're going to be, if you're not careful, trying to affect that transition too late from a global standpoint.
Bank of America Merrill Lynch has set aside $125 billion over 10 years for low-carbon investments, such as this initiative with Clean Star, which helped people in Mozambique move from cooking with charcoal to clean fuel. The bank is also part of the new Catalytic Finance Initiative, a consortium investing in sustainable projects. So who else is investing? The emerging markets, and the number one issuer of green bonds is China. But it still isn't enough.
Annual investments in clean tech is already somewhere between $130 to $325 billion annually, and we're seeing very comparable numbers for efficiency. And for each, this is roughly five times where we were investing in around 10 years ago. But with that said, the investment gap that we still face for the 2-degree trajectory is somewhere between $650 to $860 billion annually between now and 2030.
Huge gap.
Huge gap.
The governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney, has weighed in support of green bonds, saying that green finance can't conceivably remain a niche interest in the medium term. And what needs to happen to grow the market is better standardisation and disclosure of what the money is spent on.
To me, it's just a kind of obvious financial decision. For example, Transport for London, they've issued a green bond because they know that there's an increasing amount of Londoners that need to be transported from one side of the city to another. So they're looking at ways to increase usage, more efficiency. It just seems to be an obvious economic decision to be more creative with the resources that you use.
As green finance becomes mainstream, Bank of America Merrill Lynch is leading the charge to transition the world to a sustainable low-carbon economy.
Now, for decades, it's been assumed that oil and solar are separate or even competing sources of energy. However, technological developments mean we could be on the verge of a future where some of the biggest solar projects in the world operate within oil fields. Nazneen Mashiri visited the Mirad project, where Petroleum Development Oman, the country's biggest oil and gas producer, is teaming up with Glasspoint Solar to not only enhance oil production with solar energy, but also reduce carbon emissions and costs.
In Oman's desert, these workers are constructing what will be one of the world's largest solar plants, Mira, which means mirror in Arabic. Glasspoint, the company behind the project, is working with the country's largest oil and gas producer, Petroleum Development Oman, or PDO, on this landmark project that uses solar energy to support oil production.
So just explain what's going on here right now, Badir.
Yes. We are installing the wall side glasses, and the crew here behind me, they're installing the glasses and securing it with the frames.
And how important is that for this project?
It is important because we need to protect the whole thing here with this giant glass house to protect it from wind, dust and rains.
The president and CEO of Glasspoint, Rod McGregor, says they use these lightweight mirrors which make the project easier to deploy and less costly.
What's unique about the mirror project is its use of what we call enclosed trough. That's the idea of putting solar inside a glasshouse. It's the first time it's been done at full scale. Second thing that makes mirror very unique is the absolute scale that we're building at. It's over 1,000 megawatts of peak energy production. It will take 6,000 tons of water and boil it every day.
This is what the glass houses will look like when they're finished. Glasspoint's pilot project has already been operating successfully for several years. Its curved mirrors track the sun and pinpoint the light on these steel pipes. The energy created is more than 100 times greater than the desert sun outside. The pipes carry water, which is boiled into steam.
This solar pilot project generates around 50 tons of emission-free steam every day. And thanks to this glasshouse structure, it can happen even when there are dust and sandstorms.
Getting oil out of the earth is an energy-intensive and polluting process. PDO, a pioneer in implementing new technology, was seeking a more sustainable and cost-effective solution.
From a technology point of view, it's simple, effective, reliable, and it's key. But in terms of the impact it has, a third of our portfolio needs is effectively composed of heavy and viscous oils that require thermal applications. In this case, steam. And the requirement is for the next 20, 30, 40, 50 years.
Oman currently uses almost a quarter of its natural gas to recover heavy crude oil. Glasspoint's project engineer says the world is looking for alternative methods.
What was happening traditionally is the oil and gas industry was going for the easy to extract oil. And that's what we've been doing for the last probably 40 years in Oman. And that reservoir of light crude is becoming more scarce and scarce. So we have to look at the other alternatives, or we have to go and get the more difficult oil right now. And it's a trend you can see all over the world. And a lot of companies are putting a lot of money in investing in technologies related to enhanced oil recovery. And what we're doing is a specific type of enhanced oil recovery. It's called thermal. And what GlassPoint is doing especially, it's called solar enhanced oil recovery. And GlassPoint so far is the only one in the industry that have that technology.
GlassPoint's technology places it in a unique position, bridging renewable and traditional energy resources. The two companies are working together to develop a solar industry out of Oman's oil-producing roots. Mirar is just the beginning of Oman's solar energy ambitions.
We have very limited natural gas resources in the country. So we need these valuable resources to make to save it for electricity generations and for other industries as well. And we can use the solar energy for making the steam for the oil and gas industry.
Mirar will also reduce carbon dioxide emissions by 300,000 tons per year, which is like removing 63,000 cars from the road.
Could not be more proud than this. Being part of the Gulf, where we've got the massive sun energy that has not been efficiently used yet.
The potential for GlassPoint and its solar oil field projects are huge. Its solar steam technology could be used around the world and for other thermal operations too, from crude stabilization to desalinization. While the oil and gas industry looks for new ways to meet rising energy demand, these mirrors and glass houses are offering a cheaper, cleaner way of extracting it.
With a growing desire to reduce CO2 emissions and air pollution across the globe, the world needs to move away from coal as a source of power. But with energy demand increasing and around 1.1 billion people still living without electricity, we need cleaner, readily available sources of energy. We visited Royal Dutch Shell to find out more about natural gas and the role it can play now and in the future energy system.
Paris, a city whose name will be indelibly associated with the global effort to beat man-made climate change after the first ever universal climate deal was agreed here in 2015.
This is the moment we finally determined we would save our planet.
And yet Paris has serious problems of its own. The sheer number of vehicles here and the amount of pollution they kick out has led the authorities to experiment with putting restrictions on traffic flows in the city centre. Air pollution isn't confined to Paris, it's a growing global challenge. Tech startup Plume Labs has developed a free app which measures air pollution in real time. From December, Plume Labs will start trialling commercially available body-worn pollution detectors.
Pollution and climate change are quite different, but at the same time quite linked in the way that sources that produce CO2, for example, will often also produce air pollution. And when you try to basically raise people's concern or interest in climate change, it's quite difficult because it's something that happens on a global level over decades. So it's hard to feel really concerned right now as an individual. But when you look at air pollution that comes from the same sources, it's something you will be exposed to locally and directly and immediately. And so it's taking the angle of air pollution is actually an interesting way of making people feel more concerned with the different sources of climate change and air pollution.
As the world's population grows and more people move to cities, the demand for power is growing. Energy companies have to find effective solutions. And some experts believe natural gas has a big part to play.
Gas has some unique advantages. One, if you deliver gas into a load center by pipe, power by pipe, I might call it, you lose all of the inefficiencies of electric transmission. If I talk about the flexibility of gas plants that can stop and start on a dime, they provide the kind of balancing services that a complex energy system of the future would require. So when you think about the environmental consequences, the beneficial operational characteristics of natural gas, it clearly has a substantial role to play in the future energy mix.
Natural gas is the cleanest burning hydrocarbon. It's abundant and versatile, helping meet growing global demand for energy. It also has considerable social benefits. Here in India, around 700 million people still rely on solid fuels like coal, dung, and wood for domestic cooking. According to the World Health Organization, exposure to smoke emissions from household solid fuels is thought to cause 500,000 deaths a year. But in recent years, natural gas usage in Gujarat has gone from near zero to 25%, providing safe, clean energy and demonstrably improving people's lives. This isn't just about reducing worldwide CO2 emissions, it's about using cleaner and less polluting fuel to limit environmental degradation and improve human health. Royal Dutch Shell has global expertise in gas extraction and supply. Martin Wetselaar specialises in helping countries transition away from polluting fuels. He has pertinent advice for energy strategists.
Really plan it thoroughly as you also move your economy to renewables. This to me is the biggest powerful move to make, is to move to a gas plus renewables energy mix in your country, and you can plan it very well together and get people like Shell, but many other suppliers in the world to think ahead of you. Do a bit of master planning, get the right infrastructure in place and clean up your air now rather than in 10 years.
The necessity of tackling CO2 emissions and improving air quality has been universally recognised. Natural gas has a key role to play in shifting our economies away from heavily polluting energy sources towards a low-carbon future.
Up next on Journey of the Drop, flying high, improving safety on offshore structures, and the importance of preparation, how the right action can save vital time in the event of an oil spill. As our roads and ports become increasingly busy, the energy industry is working hard to find alternatives to high carbon fuels. For Royal Dutch Shell, LNG is one answer. The company is supplying liquefied natural gas to power trucks and ships to help meet growing transport demands and tackle emissions. Nick Thatcher has more.
A fuel stop for this delivery driver, but her lorry doesn't run on conventional diesel. It's powered instead by liquefied natural gas. Using LNG in transport can reduce sulfur emissions, particulates and nitrogen oxides, as well as greenhouse gas emissions. And spark-ignited engines used to burn the fuel can also reduce noise.
The main advantages of this are air quality. If you compare heavy fuel oil to liquefied natural gas, there's a very, very big difference in terms of the air quality effect of it. But of course, natural gas is also cleaner from a CO2 perspective. So you produce less carbon, you produce a lot less air pollution.
And because lorries that run on LNG are quieter, it also means they can operate and deliver at night in residential areas without disturbing people and at times when there are fewer vehicles on the road.
Albert Heijn is the largest supermarket chain in the Netherlands, with almost 1,000 stores across the country. And key to its continuing success is the efficient transportation of stock from its distribution centres to its shop floors. 5 years ago, after realising almost a tenth of its delivery time was being lost through drivers stuck in traffic jams, the company decided to invest in a fleet of LNG-powered lorries that could operate around the clock and comply with noise restrictions.
An LNG truck makes less noise, 8 decibel less than a normal diesel truck. A normal diesel truck has 80 decibel as noise level. 72 is the maximum noise level of an LNG truck now, but in the next future it will be lower than 70. So that's amazing. That means that we can operate during the night, during the evening, in the early morning, and that gives a lot of possibilities.
Shell is an LNG pioneer with more than 50 years of expertise. It believes that natural gas not only has the potential to offer fuel cost savings when compared to conventional diesel, but as the cleanest burning hydrocarbons, it also has an important role to play in the transport energy mix, alongside developments in vehicle efficiency, biofuels, hydrogen, and electric mobility. Already, LNG is powering transport in 80 ships in operation around the world. 4,000 trucks in the USA, 200,000 trucks and buses in China, and 1,500 heavy-duty trucks in Europe. And those numbers keep growing, for in September 2016, the cruise line operator Carnival announced it had commissioned two new ships to be powered by LNG from Shell, as part of a green initiative to reduce its environmental impact.
It's a very exciting development in the LNG to transport, or specifically LNG to shipping business. I didn't realize until recently, if you have a cruise ship with about 7,000 to 8,000 people on it, it used the amount of power that a village of 30,000 people does. Now they can make it more comfortable and sustainable as they bring more and more ships into service that are LNG powered instead of fuel oil powered. And I think that's the beginning of something really big, and we're quite proud to be at that beginning.
Our roads as well as our ports are becoming increasingly busy. And across the world, the challenge is to meet this rising transport demand while reducing emissions. Liquefied natural gas from Shell is part of the solution, a new transport fuel that is cleaner, greener, and quieter.
The Aberdeen City region has been at the heart of the global energy industry for decades and is determined to lead from the front as the sector embraces future opportunities. Forward planning and innovation will be crucial, along with a long-term commitment to billions of pounds of investment in vital infrastructure projects. Paul Brennan went to find out more.
With its iconic skyline and bustling port, Aberdeen is well known as a global hub in the oil and gas sector. But these are challenging times for the industry. Nevertheless, it's proving to be a true renaissance region. Billions of pounds has been spent on infrastructure, including one of Europe's biggest road building projects, a master plan to transform the city centre, a new conference and exhibition centre, and a deep water port. Just part of an ambitious plan to ensure the Aberdeen City region remains a world leader in oil and gas.
Over the last four decades, we've built up a great deal of expertise and technology. We believe that we can export that around the world. We want to anchor the supply chain here in the Northeast, where that expertise has been built up. And we want to support the supply chain to make sure that they can do business from this area for many, many years to come.
Just a few miles outside of Aberdeen lies West Hill, a kind of Silicon Valley of the oil and gas world, and home to a cluster of subsea businesses. In addition, the Energetica initiative has encouraged many oil, gas and associated businesses to set up here.
The Energetica corridor is the corridor which exists from the very north of Aberdeen reaching up to Peterhead, one of our northern towns. And that area is marked by some spectacular coastlines, some spectacular beaches, world-class leisure opportunities, rapidly improving digital and physical road infrastructure. And what we're hoping to do is to attract some real cutting-edge technology clusters there where people are attracted by the success of others. We have the employment land available, we have fantastic public services there. It's a great place to live, to invest, to raise your family, and we're hoping that that can become the next area of growth in the region.
With up to 20 billion barrels of oil equivalent still held in the North Sea, the industry remains a key part of Aberdeen's future. In reaction to the downturn in oil prices, sharp focus has been placed on collaboration and development of new technologies, which have driven a 45% reduction in operating costs. Looking to the future, a multi-million pound oil and gas technology centre will help to anchor the supply chain in the region based on the subsea technologies, mature field management and decommissioning expertise that exist here.
Even though the North Sea is a very mature basin, our supply chain don't have as much of the export market as you would assume globally. So we want to increase that and bring in ultimately probably multiple billions of additional value to the northeast of Scotland. And that's all related to high value jobs, high value skills and increased capability. And it would further increase not just beyond the supply chain, but also into the university capability. Because one of the aims of the technology centre is to create centres of excellence.
Aberdeen's two universities universities are key partners in supporting the next generation to fully exploit the opportunities the region offers. Engineers of the future at Robert Gordon University use state-of-the-art technology to learn, understand and explore the oil and gas industry.
There's lots of different training opportunities in the oil and gas industry itself, and it's often on the forefront of technological sort of development. There's a different challenge every day, I'm finding anyway, when I'm working. So it's a good industry to work in.
Aberdeen-born Sir Ian Wood is one of the most respected figures in the oil and gas sector. He has committed £25 million of his own money to Opportunity North East, aimed at anchoring the oil and gas supply chain and diversifying the region's economy.
Key objectives: maximising the offshore oil and gas opportunity for the North East of Scotland in the meantime, looking at ways to keep the oil and gas industry here post the North Sea, and actually that's now looking a lot more hopeful than it was. And then thirdly, broadening the economy, diversifying and developing. We've chosen food, drink and agriculture, life sciences and tourism as three industries alongside oil as the key planks we're going to try and build up and maximise.
Despite the changing times, it's clear that the Aberdeen City region is very much open for business, with oil and gas at the heart of a vibrant and diverse economy.
Coal is one of our oldest energy sources, yet in recent times, we've seen energy providers move away from coal towards greener sources of generating power. Well, Semplastics believe they can repurpose coal in a more environmentally friendly way. Steve Moore travelled to Florida to see how their XMAP technology could revolutionise propant performance.
The work taking place in this laboratory in Orlando could help revolutionize the oil and gas industry. Here, scientists with Semplastics are creating what they call XMAT materials.
It's about reimagining high-performance materials. So if you look at plastics, they have certain characteristics. They're lightweight, easily manufactured. Ceramics can handle high temperatures. They're chemically resistant. Metals have certain characteristics. So XMAT is really a different way of looking at materials where you put them together to make a unique high-performance material that hasn't been made before.
The inventors of the XMAT system say taking the best properties of different materials and combining them has exciting potential, particularly in the energy sector. They believe their XMAT technology could hold the key to cheaper, greener energy, using a substance not often associated with clean fuels – coal. Semplastic CEO Bill Easter shows me how his company mixes coal with its proprietary resin, a precursor to ceramic material, to create a high-performance, low-cost alternative XMAT propant for oil and gas drilling.
We're taking this sand, which is silicon and oxygen, and we're turning it into a polymeric liquid sand, so silicon oxygen in this, and then we're mixing this with the coal, the carbon in the coal, and we turn it into this very lightweight propant. You know, we have to have energy, and so it really is a it's taking coal from perhaps a form where we're burning it, and it's giving us all these carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases. And we're taking it and turning it into a much greener form of component to get out energy in a much greener way.
This chamber you see sticking out the door, we had to create that ourselves.
Varani Hill, Chief Technology Officer with Semplastics, the implications for the oil and gas industry are enormous, giving well drillers an alternative propant.
Some of the higher dollar ceramic-based propants are high density and they don't stay put. So this material being strong and light, it'll be easier to put into place with their technology, and it makes it better.
The coal industry has been bruised by a trend towards natural gas and alternative energy sources in the United States and elsewhere. But Semplastics believes by using it in its XMAT propant, coal may once again have a bright future in energy generation.
We're giving coal a place to be used instead of burning it. We can still use it to help get energy by putting it back in the ground. we mix it with our materials and we pump it back in the ground. So the coal industry may like that. We're talking billions of pounds.
And being lightweight means Semplastics proppant is cheaper to pump and costs less to transport than sand.
The price performance ratio is like, it's something that they've never seen before. So they're used to sand at the low end and they're used to ceramic at the high end. And so somewhat low performing to high performing. But in this case, you have something that is very high performance, perhaps better than ceramic, and in the same cost regime as sand. So that's what's unique about it.
Helping in the development of XMAT is a collaboration with the University of Central Florida, where researchers are taking a closer look at the materials.
By examining XMAT materials under powerful microscopes, UCF scientists can see in detail how these unique materials hold together and look for ways to make them even lighter and stronger. And because Semplastics has found a way to use fillers such as coal to make lightweight but tough materials much thicker than ever before, they say the potential applications are wide-ranging.
This is one of our prototype telescope mirrors here. This is actually just a test article. It's a scaled-down version of what we're going to deliver to NASA.
Typically, it was always made as a thin coating, this technology. Now, the breakthrough is it can go from something an eighth inch thick, which was its limit. That's as thick as you could make these materials. Now they're being made inches thick. And so that's a game changer right there. You can make bulk parts and components from XMAT.
Meanwhile, at Semplastics, the research goes on, a small company looking for never-before-discovered materials that could one day make a big difference. And with the proper investment from the right strategic partner, XMAT will move from the laboratory to energy production wells.
Now, the socio-economic trend towards a mix of energy sources is creating more need to diversify portfolios to include both renewables and unconventionals. In this new environment, the right consultancy and management is key to success. RPS Energy works with clients on every aspect of their projects to offer an integrated approach across the entire asset lifecycle, as Joanna Simpson reports.
The energy landscape is changing. Companies are diversifying their portfolios to include renewables and unconventionals, alongside the more traditional sources of oil and gas. As well as supporting companies in the changing energy environment, RPS is embracing new ways of working, such as using innovative technology like drones. Geological data acquired from footage of rock formations like here in Ireland is ultimately used to help understand 3D models. As well as doing technical work for companies, RPS says it can assist with the full life cycle of an asset through project management, upstream, mid, and downstream.
We are technical specialists, and what we can do is build a team who can work with that client and see their project through. And that could be a drilling project, that could be a development project where they're installing a platform, pipelines, it could be a major field development. Where they start off, where that we're looking at the permitting, we would bring environmental specialists in, we would bring operational specialists in who can oversee the offshore aspects of it.
When a startup company needed to assess opportunities in Africa for drilling platforms, it came to RPS for independent advice. RPS is a British firm with a global outlook. It has 250 clients in 150 countries. This diversity and expert knowledge was invaluable for the startup for their venture in Ghana.
Having someone with the skills that have seen so many opportunities around Africa before, they would have analogues, they would have the expertise to be able to analyse the geophysics, put a geological picture together, do the petroleum reservoir engineering as to how well this would flow, and even take it through to a commercial analysis. Having that independent view, rather than having the wool pulled over our eyes, was very useful.
One of the areas in which RPS works is subsurface evaluation, looking at things like this reservoir. A 3D model breaks it down into cells. A simulation shows what will happen if oil and gas are extracted. This helps assess the most efficient way to develop an oil field to maximise production.
We're going to assess the profitability.
RPS is well known for its consulting, including producing independent reports. These cover a host of areas: HSE environmental impact assessments, competent persons reports, independent commercial valuations, and reserves reports. Independent resource estimates are critical in all these areas, and RPS reports illustrate the potential production of an oil or gas field and show its development costs and resulting value.
What we, I think, are unique in doing is providing a very integrated perspective, so that not only do we look at the subsurface and the surface facilities required, but in addition to that, we have teams that look at the commercialization, say, of gas. We have an economics team. We have a team that looks at the HSE aspects of a development or of a producing field. So they can look at the track record on environmental discharges, on their safety record.
Following the oil price crash and continued uncertainty, RPS says a key energy source for the future is gas.
Firstly, it's a very plentiful resource. People like the IEA estimated independently that there's over 200 years of gas available. Which means that it's there for the long-term future. It's a very clean source of energy and highly efficient. Also, interestingly, it's a resource that can be brought on stream relatively quickly.
RPS has worked on 20,000 projects since 2003. It says it's involved in some of the most important and challenging infrastructure, environmental, energy and development projects as the energy environment continues to change.
Well, I'm very pleased to say that Dr. Piers Reamer, Director General of the World Petroleum Council, joins me now. Well, there is an increasing appetite, isn't there, for greener fuels. Is there room for oil and gas in that new world?
There's lots of room for oil and gas in making our fuels greener, but also you'll find that oil and gas companies are doing a lot themselves in developing new types of solar panels, new biological processes for producing fuels. And I think when you look to the future, and you look at all the estimates by all the international bodies on where we're going to be for the next 30 or 40 years, yes, there are vast increases in renewable energy, but we also need everything. Because we have so many people and we need so much energy, we need a mix. So oil and gas will still be there, but our challenge is to produce what people want in a sustainable manner.
The industry does have its challenges though, doesn't it? I mean, it doesn't always have the best of reputations. I think it's fair to say that.
That is fair, yes. We do get a bad press sometimes. Often I think it's because people only think about us and think about what we do when they fill up their car with petrol. I think people don't realise the benefit to society of everything that we do, or the things in everyday life that they use, which come from fossil fuels. And it's not just fuel for our cars, it's producing electricity, it's producing polymers, plastics, pharmaceuticals, cosmetics. Everything around us here in this building is probably derived in some form or another from oil and gas. But we also have lots of challenges in extracting all these products. We have geological challenges, geopolitical challenges, price challenges, and technical challenges. In fact, to give an example, when you go on holiday and you're in your jumbo jet at 34,000 feet, the distance you're at in that aeroplane to the ground are the distances that we're drilling underground, and we're doing that to centimetre accuracy.
So huge challenges. Do you have enough people in the industry? How's recruitment going?
We don't have enough people, no. It is interesting though, because we have 70 member countries, we see issues from all around the world. So particularly with young people and recruitment, it's a sort of East and West problem. If you look at our Eastern members, if you talk to people in India and China and you say about a recruitment problem, they say, well, young people see it as an honour to join the oil and gas industry. How many engineers do you want? How many chemists do you want? In the West, it's slightly different. People aren't as keen to study science subjects anymore, and it is more of an issue. We try to do our bit at the World Petroleum Council. We have young professionals committees in many of our member countries, and we also have legacy programmes. We're a charity in the UK because all the money that we make from our activities goes into educational legacies. And that varies from sending people through universities at graduate level right down to some projects, for example, we have in Pakistan where we're doing vocational training, where we're teaching people basic English, basic IT, and then basic welding skills, plumbing skills. So we do a whole range, or try to do a whole range ourselves as well.
And it's difficult to quantify actually the number of different opportunities available in the industry, isn't it? Because it's just such a huge range, it's hard to kind of pin them all down, I should think.
It is. In fact, there is really something for everybody. There are so many disciplines. From, you have all the sciences, you have the chemists, the physicists, all the engineers, biologists, environmentalists, social scientists, economists. You've covered the whole range. Most of those disciplines, you're at the cutting edge. And that's the fun of it as well, because often when you're working in projects, I'm a chemist by training, but often you're put into an environment where you're working with people that think a lot differently to you.
What about energy poverty? What have you got to say on that subject matter?
Again, that's something that we care about an awful lot, because we do seem to be in a bizarre situation where we have a world that seems to be awash with energy, and we still do have energy poverty. We have over 1 billion people that have no access to clean fuels, no access to electricity. And that's something that we're working on with United Nations Sustainability for All programme, with the OPEC Fund for International Development, looking at how we can get clean electricity and cleaner fuels into the people that need it most.
And with a growing global population, none of your problems are going away, are they?
No, and in fact, people very rarely talk about population, because When I was about this high, the population was 3 billion, and just in my lifetime, the world population has doubled. We can guarantee there'll be more people. Everybody wants energy. Everybody wants water. Everybody wants food. They want it all to be clean. They want everything to be produced in a socially acceptable and a sustainable manner. So yes, we have an interesting challenge for many years to come.
Well, we certainly look forward to finding out a little bit more about your industry and how it works over the months to come. Thank you very much indeed for coming and outlining some of those issues for us. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You're watching Journey of the Drop. Coming up on the programme...
I'm in Oman, reporting on one of the challenges of hydrocarbon exploration and production, transporting the thousands of people involved safely. And I'm in Calgary, where we'll be looking at the many benefits of a fair and transparent regulatory structure.
Now, one of the biggest factors contributing to the cost of wind power is the difficulty of getting repair and maintenance personnel onto the turbines in rough seas. But innovative new winching systems being developed by Limpet Technology have the potential to deliver the safety and cost savings to make wind power much more affordable. Edward Barron reports now from Edinburgh.
Increasing the safety and productivity of wind turbines is critical to their future contribution to our energy needs. Limpet Technology's current generation of systems have been used to improve safety and efficiency in the sector since 2012 by addressing applications such as rotor blade repair and long ladder climb assist. Now they're devising a new solution which has the potential to change the face of the offshore industry.
Well, if you take a look down there, you get a real sense of the challenges offshore wind technicians face when they transfer between boat and turbine. It can be pretty choppy. And now a new generation of height safety systems is set to solve those problems and bring down the cost of offshore wind power.
The reason it's important and significant is because it is going to allow transfers to take place in a safer manner and more frequently. That has significant financial benefits to the industry and significant safety benefits. You can imagine the costs that are associated with a bunch of technicians heading out onto an offshore turbine fuel vessel people, etc., not being able to transfer onto the turbine.
The potential risks of transferring in high seas can clearly be seen in this mobile phone footage shot at a wind farm off the coast of North Wales. The industry tends to prohibit ladder transfers taking place when waves are above 1.5 metres significant height. But with Limpet's new transfer system, the ambition is to offer a solution that's capable of assuring safe operation when waves are up to 3 metres in height.
Our motion programmable equipment allows us to simulate vessel movement in sea states up to 2 metre significant wave. Our intelligent marine transfer system tracks this movement very quickly and allows a technician to be clipped into our system when he's on the deck, then step across or hoist clear of the deck onto the transfer ladder to get away from the high-risk zone quickly, easily, and more safely.
Independent service providers who need efficient access to turbines have welcomed this development.
There isn't anything available at the moment in our sector that will enable a technician to get off of a boat in more than 1.5 metres swell. So it's a game changer. It's going to ensure that we can get there quicker, we can get there faster, we become more efficient. And generally, yeah, I just think a massive benefit to the offshore sector.
The main driver of the project is the requirement for the offshore wind energy industry to lower its operating costs. With the next generation of offshore wind farms being situated ever further from shore, allowing the turbines to be accessed in high sea states will be critical to keeping them running efficiently. Clients suggest that raising the safe transfer limit from 1.5 metres to 2.5 metres will mean access to far offshore wind farms will be possible for 80% of the year instead of just 50%.
The difference that it can make is huge, it's massive. The availability of technicians being able to get onto these turbines in more extreme environments is really limited by the sea state. So if we have a machine that can operate in higher sea states, then the availability of that equipment goes up. Therefore, technicians and workers can get onto the turbine.
The Leavenmouth wind turbine here in Fife is playing a key role in helping to demonstrate current limpets being used for applications such as ladder climb assist, rescue and rotor blade repair, and will play a key role in testing prototypes of the new offshore transfer system. This massive 7-megawatt machine is the largest open-access turbine dedicated to research and development for the offshore renewable sector.
It offers innovative supply chain companies such as Limpet Technologies the opportunity to prove and demonstrate their technology on an operational turbine. And this is absolutely crucial for convincing investors and also wind farm operators that the technology is safe and ready to be deployed on offshore wind farm sites.
Limpet says once their new technology is brought to market, it will be transferable to other applications such as oil and gas. And for the offshore wind turbine sector, it will very soon be on the way to achieving a safer and more productive future.
Companies face many challenges in the exploration and production of hydrocarbons, with driving a particular focus for many due to the long distances and extreme conditions. Safety is an overarching priority at Petroleum Development Oman, with road safety a key focus to ensure that its people are kept safe as they go about their daily work. Nazanin Moshiri travelled to Oman to see how this investment in people and technology is not only improving safety, but increasing operational efficiency too.
In this vast and inhospitable desert, drivers from Petroleum Development Oman, or PDO, must travel cautiously. There are many risks, including the unpredictable weather, the blinding sun and the road conditions.
There is some risks in the desert, roads, like driving while storm dust, also that flying stones from the other vehicles, the other road users who unsafe driving, who speeding, overspeeding, you can see who overtaking the vehicles in the wrong locations.
Ahmed is among 8,000 employees and more than 45,000 contractors who work for PDO. Its operation area or concession is around 90,000 square kilometres.
To give you a feel of dimensions and logistical challenge, every day our staff and our contractors, as they access wells, facilities, pipelines, have to travel the equivalent to the moon and back every single workday.
PDO spends more than $1 million a year on training its drivers. What they learn here in the classroom is put to the test outside. The rules are simple. Buckle up, drive within the speed limits, and be aware of potential dangers before they happen. This is also part of the training. A rollover simulator shows drivers what it might be like to be involved in an accident. And this is a seatbelt convincer.
Whew! That felt quite strong. That was 7 kilometres an hour, and I really felt myself moving forward. And it was actually a little bit painful there. You can imagine what it'd be like if you're speeding at, say, 10 kilometres, 20 or even 50 kilometres an hour and involved in a crash. This is all part of PDO's strategy to try to change the culture of safety here in Oman.
But PDO's research discovered that training is not enough. Rules need enforcement too. All of PDO's vehicles are fitted with an in-vehicle monitoring system, or IVMS, which tells staff at this control centre a driver's location and speed.
We are monitoring up to 6,000 vehicles in a day here.
There's very much link between the monitoring and compliance. If you do not monitor, people don't comply. They think, you know, the system is there, but nobody is working on it, and I can do whatever I like. People who do not comply, there is a consequence on it. And if you don't monitor, you won't know that the people are actually complying, and therefore you'll not give consequence, and therefore people will not actually change their behavior.
But IVMS isn't just a punishment tool. It also ensures drivers don't go over their hours, because fatigue can lead to mistakes and accidents. And it helps keep those in remote locations safe.
It can control people who are driving outside that duty time. So it can control all vehicles. So we can also allocate the location of the team, either in the field or outside the field.
But PDO can't control the behaviour of other drivers on the road. Marwan Al-Wadahi lost his parents in a car crash. They weren't wearing seatbelts. He told me, although fate is destined, people can avoid disasters like what happened to him by understanding the risks and complying with the rules of the road.
The campaign is not only focusing on educating people or raising the road safety awareness, but also to share PDO's wealth on road safety. So what we are trying to do is use what we are having of training material and share with them our experience and so on, and also enlighten people on what PDO is doing.
It's tragedies like this that persuaded PDO to launch a nationwide campaign called Tell a Friend. This is one of several adverts which focus on what is at stake.
PDO's commitment to road safety and the huge investment in that sector has paid us by ensuring that everyone operates with us is safe, and at the same time, the reputation of the company is at stake. So it's really very critical for us to ensure that everyone is safe. So the commitment of PDO's management to road safety is playing a critical role in that operation.
PDO has gone beyond its remit within the oil and gas sector. Its safety campaign is influencing the community around it and hopefully saving many lives.
Oil companies are becoming increasingly vigilant about preventing oil spills and being ready to act quickly to minimise damage and disruption should an incident occur. Oil Spill Response Limited is the largest industry-funded cooperative that responds to global oil spills, and their readiness and preparedness work is ensuring that oil companies are able to respond quickly in the event of an incident. Sharon Thomas has more.
Oil spills can be devastating, both to human life and marine life. The impact may be felt for generations. Oil Spill Response Limited, or OSRL, is an industry-funded company which responds to spills right across the globe. It's the largest organisation of its kind.
Well, obviously, oil spills are very damaging to the environment, and what oil spill response does is get there as quickly as possible to mitigate the worst impacts and ensure that it's done in the right way so the environment can fully recover from that oil spill in the best possible way. And to do that, we help people prepare for it in advance by writing plans, exercising, training people and providing experts, so that, and these things are exercised on a regular basis so that if it happens, we can respond.
OSRL helps oil companies respond to spills from its bases around the world. It's always ready to respond with world-class resources, anytime, anywhere.
This fence boom is a standard but essential piece of response equipment. It's foam-filled, quick to deploy anywhere in the world, and this one is particularly used in calm waters, such as ports and harbours, to contain a spill and to deflect oil from sensitive areas.
As well as having a multi-million pound stockpile of equipment for response, the company also hires out kit for weeks, days, even years, with maintenance and professional training on how to deploy being an integral part of the service.
Today, we're going to be focusing on our shoreline cleanup.
OSRL trains people from industry bodies, governments, and the oil companies themselves. A variety of training courses are available for all levels of expertise that could be required in a response.
So this is your framework. You have your 15 response capabilities.
The company was set up in 1985, and specialist staff have an in-depth practical experience of responding to real incidents, all of which serves to mitigate the potential damage a spill can cause. Planning is paramount.
To have an effective response, to be able to minimize an impact from oil spill, means you need to identify your risks. So you do your planning scenarios, you'll be able to identify where the oil spill could impact, what response techniques, what resources you need to have in place, and this whole process will enable you to do a quick response.
After the Macondo incident in the Gulf of Mexico in 2010, the oil industry collaborated to design and manufacture equipment to respond to a well control incident. Since then, OSRL holds this equipment on behalf of the industry, ready to mobilise in response to a major subsea incident.
It's absolutely imperative that we all work together. Now we have equipment that's pre-designed, pre-manufactured and in place in a response-ready state. It really does reduce the response time, which in turn minimises the environmental impact.
Do you know when exactly the release happened and is it still ongoing?
OSRL's Emergency Operations Centre is on call 24/7. All spills are coordinated from here, mobilising equipment and specialist personnel.
Once a client has contacted us and reached for our expertise, this room becomes the nerve center of all our operations. This is where we gather our personnel and our experts to start assessing the situation, identifying equipment and personnel to ship worldwide and respond in field.
Oil spill response, preparedness for combating spills and mitigating environmental impact.
You need the fire brigade, you need the ambulance service. Oil spill response is the same kind of thing for oil spills.
Now, there can be significant economic, social and even environmental benefits of a national petroleum sector when a fair and transparent regulatory infrastructure is in place. Sproule, an independent energy consulting service, brings together its policy experience and technical expertise to offer an impartial service rooted by the national context of the country being supported. Francis Reed went to Calgary to find out how Sproule's service can create value and mitigate risk in new regions.
It's an exciting industry. Never before have there been so many changes, from oil and gas to renewable energy. It's a sector that's constantly evolving. And that means more and more are relying on Sproule, a consulting firm that helps to put in place fair, competitive and transparent regulatory systems for energy markets across the world. And as countries such as Brazil, Mexico, Iran, Oman and India continue to commercialise their oil and gas resources, it's never been more crucial.
Why? Because with a strong regulatory structure that's fair and transparent, it's not only sustainable and accountable, it's competitive too.
Sproule has a deep technical and commercial knowledge and has helped everyone from governments to financial institutions as well as E&P companies, and it's impartial advice that leads to success.
Sproule is a company that's built off of a foundation of engineers and geoscientists with a focus on the upstream oil and gas sector. And we've been around for 65 years. And we've been involved in everything in the upstream sector, from the discovery and finding of the reserves to how to economically produce them and everything else in between. We don't have a vested interest in the, let's say, the assets or the outcomes. And therefore, our work is to really start with using good data and our interpretation of that data for a solution. And what we're really focused on is really trying to help clients make better decisions, and decisions that are geared towards really building sustainable prosperity for the clients, for the communities, and for the countries that have assets in the resource sector. We're there to provide the best solution possible, and to do that, we work objectively. We come at it as an independent evaluator or assessor of what the issues are and how to implement them.
In implementing a strong regulatory structure, they can help meet economic challenges through developing natural resources, reduce risk in certain geographies while growing a free market economy, enabling companies to explore more opportunities worldwide with confidence and engage local communities to benefit their futures too.
COP21 and all of the climate change policy that we've seen have made governments and regulators think about how they can do their work differently and strengthen their regulatory framework. And so whether we're talking about countries in the Middle East, South America, certainly in Africa, even in Canada, regulators are changing the way that they do work. It's important for communities to be involved, and it's important for people to know that they can trust regulators. And so the work that we provide is advice on how to think about how that work can be done better. It doesn't mean that what regulators are doing now hasn't been good enough until now, but the world has changed. Citizens are concerned about climate, they're concerned about their communities, they're concerned about economic development. And the experience that we have from around the world is to be able to say that if you take certain approaches, you'll get better regulatory outcomes, which will lead to greater investment. It'll allow for certainty for investors and companies coming into your jurisdiction. And that's what we talk about with our clients.
The cornerstone of any regulatory framework starts with a deep understanding of the reservoir.
All companies anywhere in the world, if they're significant, are interested in doing sustainable development and doing it in an environmentally, socially, economically sustainable way. And that goes without saying. Sproule's advantage is that they are fundamentally a geoscience company. And geology surpasses all the other factors, fiscal, law, rules, and so on. If you don't have the geology right, and you don't have that geological information there so that investors can be attracted, then you're dead in the water.
It goes back to this global world we live in, and there's a lot of countries that are looking to reposition themselves in terms of how they are using their resources, and we believe we can help everyone address their issues. This is the future.
Sproule thinks global but acts local, and in a dynamic and interconnected energy ecosystem, that's crucial for nations building or enhancing their regulatory structure. This has long-term benefits for producers, governments, investors, and communities alike.
As governments across the world move towards alternative methods of energy production, there are concerns about the consequences of this push for renewable energy. In the developing world, the demand for coal remains high, and in the Western Hemisphere, energy suppliers continue to rely on coal to provide job stability to the electricity grid and job prospects for local communities. Lorna Shaddick went to see how Javelin Global Commodities is working to help the modern coal industry provide efficient energy solutions.
The latest technology, both below ground and above. You'll see more robots and computer screens than pickaxes and shovels in today's coal mines, including this one owned by Murray Energy in Ohio.
The real battle these days, though, isn't getting the coal out, it's finding buyers for it, as times change and energy suppliers in the US and Europe increasingly switch to gas and renewables.
People have been mining coal in this part of Ohio since the 1800s and using the mighty Ohio River to ship it on to the rest of the US. Murray Energy is carrying on that legacy today. But in the modern world, it can't just rely on the market here in America. So it's looking for other ways to diversify.
And that's where marketing and trading firm Javelin Global Commodities comes in. As times and demands change, its CEO is working with Murray Energy's founder and chairman, Robert Murray, to help the firm reduce costs and sell to a wider market, including the developing world, where people tend to feel differently about coal.
People's perception on coal is a very negative thing, unfortunately. Whereas out in the East, there's a slightly different opinion. People are much more focused on development. People are focused on turning their lights on. Because we have a global business model, is when someone is burning coal in East, Southeast Asia, they may not be burning coal in Europe. So you move that coal from Europe down to Asia. So you have a natural insurance by having a large portfolio of both producers and consumers from around the globe.
That demand for coal in different markets means that thanks to Javelin, Murray Energy's product is now shipped not only in North America, but also as far afield as South America and even India, where coal production and consumption is actually growing. Javelin's also trying to help Murray Energy logistically, as renewables wash away the old ways of the coal industry.
There's a lot of uncertainty around when the coal-fired generation runs. So if it's sunny, it's not running. If it's cloudy, it's probably running. And so there's a lot of uncertainty about when people burn. So therefore, the utilities are looking for something with a floating volume. So that they want, when they need coal, they need to bring it on short notice. Now, it's not going to be, coal's not going to be 50, 60% of the grid in the West, but it could be a 20 to 30% grid stabilizer. So what we're trying to bring to these guys is both a floating price environment, because they're a lot more exposed to the fluctuations in power pricing, and secondly, floating volumes. So we're managing that volume risk.
For Murray Energy's founder and CEO, Robert Murray, who's been in the business nearly 60 years, that help has been crucial, particularly as times get tough politically.
The coal industry is now one half in volume and one half in the price of coal of what it was the day that Barack Obama was elected president. The management of Javelin Global Commodities, based in London, has the greatest expertise in the world in coal trading and coal marketing around the world. In collaboration together, we're able to market Murray Energy coal from the United States. But it is vital when the markets domestically go away, we have to transfer to the international markets.
And there's a lot at stake. Thousands of men and women make their living from mining, not only in this part of Ohio, but across the U.S. They say it's a vital part of the community.
Really, if you want a good job around this area, you know, the mines are really the only things left.
I come across people daily who work for Murray Energy, whether it be at a sporting event for my children or if it's at church. There are people everywhere that I go that I either work with at my mine site or I know work for the company.
Murray Energy is the economy here for the most part. It provides jobs, not just for miners, but for every one miner, between 9 and 11 jobs feed off of that one miner.
Peter Bradley wants to help keep those jobs in Ohio, and he says part of Javelin's secret to helping coal businesses succeed is actually focusing on more than just coal itself. As low-cost, high-tech natural gas becomes more popular in America, Javelin's working to help Murray Energy build a flexible export market and to help utilities in the US adapt.
These commodities all move together. So if you just trade one commodity by themselves, you're probably missing some information about what's going on another commodity, which could impact the price of the other. So there is some high correlation between different energy commodities today. So I think it's important to be involved in that. A lot of the expertise that we've developed within our coal industry are very, very adaptable into other industries. We recently set up Javelin Hydrocarbon, which is to get involved in the refined oil and natural gas business, as that competes directly with coal, for example.
Coal mining couldn't be any closer to everyday life here, but to keep it that way amid changing times and changing perceptions, mines like this are expanding their horizons. Murray Energy hopes that Javelin's future-proofing strategies will mean they're in the swim at the heart of this community for decades to come.
The WPC's Future Leaders Forum is the largest gathering of young professionals in the petroleum industry. We sent our reporter to the forum in Rio de Janeiro to speak to the next generation of leaders about sustainability, business leadership and innovation.
I'm really delighted that this fifth Global Youth Event is here in Rio. We have an exciting future in industry ahead of us.
For the first time, Brazil hosted the Future Leaders Forum. Speakers debated about the importance of the new generation arriving into the industry, the diverse careers available, and how they plan to reshape the sector. And we've been speaking to some of them about the role they hope to play in the future.
It's been tipped as a collaborative global gathering, home to 540 exhibitors and thousands of delegates all traveling here from 22 countries around the world. We've been speaking to some of the biggest names in the industry, such as WPC President Joseph Toth, Ivan Martin from BCG, and Milton Costa, Secretary General for the Brazilian Petroleum Institute.
Our industry is facing a big turning point. And now is the time of the crew change. So young professionals, future leaders, who will be in charge of taking the lead and continue with the works in our industry.
So we need to develop young professionals as quickly as possible for them to fulfill the roles that are expected from them in a few years. As the crew change.
These young leaders are hoping to take the industry into a new era of sustainability, which is one of the major issues being discussed here today.
The biggest challenge is to be more acceptable to the environmentalists. I am a petroleum engineer, and I view my role as in the future as to make sure, it's not only to make sure that enough oil is there, but to make sure that our oil is competitive, not from a price standpoint, because it is competitive from a price standpoint, but it's competitive in terms of its effect on the environment.
This sustainability depends on new technological advances in the sector. So innovation is at the forefront of many delegates' minds here.
I think we have to modify our point of view. We have been thinking for all the time that we sell gasoline and diesel. That's true, we sell gasoline and diesel, but citizens, people who buy, are not buying gasoline, are buying mobility, flexibility, and other kind of things. And we have to communicate them that we are very proud of our products.
We are facing, at the moment, very exciting times in the oil and gas industry. Things are changing very fast because we can see a lot of emerging technologies and potential disruptions. In the oil and gas business.
Examples of innovation were seen during the premiere of Journey of the Drop, the new style program made by WPC and ITN Productions.
We'll be finding out about the Journey of the Drop, where oil and gas come from, and the many ways they're being used by all of us every day around the world.
Another topic in the spotlight here is gender equality. Lack of women in the industry is increasingly hitting top of the agenda.
I think that we need much more diversity and much more inclusion in the industry. We need to integrate women because we need them. We need them if the industry is going to grow. We cannot not afford not to have half of the population not being able to enter the industry.
Women bring diversity of thought, and women are also brought up since childhood to be more of the moderators and to be more empathetic for discussions, and they bring more solutions to choose from.
Many people, many organizations, many ideas, all cooperating and collaborating to help define and inspire the future.
Leadership is a very important element of our future. WPC is a knowledge-sharing basis. The organization itself accumulates substantial knowledge about the industry, and we are ready to share. And we are, it's our obligation, not only ready, but it's our obligation to share this information.
Thank you for watching Journey of the Drop. We hope you've enjoyed the programme, exploring the issues faced and the opportunities available to those working within the oil and gas sector. All of our reports are available to view on the WPC's website. The details are on the screen now. From me and the rest of the team here, thank you for watching. Goodbye.